Tony Robbins.
How you doing, Laura? Thank you.
This is one of the loudest, most enthusiastic crowds I've ever seen here. And it is no surprise. You're here to talk about Unshakeable, your
new
book.
I see you
book.
Got quite a poster here.
I know. Well, look, what a handsome
guy. This guy's bigger than I am. It's amazing.
This is your step-by-step guide to money mastery.
Yes.
And I'm curious about the timing, because just 2 years ago, you wrote another book about
yes.
money, a much bigger one.
Yes.
What made you decide to publish a second book about money so close on the heels of the first one?
Well, I like writing books about as much as pulling out my eyelashes. I'm not a writer, but I love people. And in 2008, when I saw all these people losing half their net worth or losing their homes, it wasn't a statistic because I grew up dirt poor. So I decided I'd interview 50 of the smartest financial people in the world and say, can the average investor really, average person really win today? Because, you know, 70% of trades in the market are high frequency trades. It doesn't look like it. The world's a pretty violent and volatile place right now. And what I found out was from those people is that anyone can win. I found out how. I wrote a 700-page tome. It was number one New York Times bestseller. I was thrilled.
But a million copies of the hardcover alone,
yeah,
isn't
no, it was
that correct?
It was truly amazing. Yeah. It was truly amazing. I feel very, very grateful. And by the way, I donated all the profits in that book. It was a $5 million advance. I put it all out, and we fed 50 million people through Feeding America, and then I matched it to do 100 million. So we fed 200 million people. But this book, in the last year and a half or 2 years, there's been so much fear. And I actually had an interview less than a year ago with the old Fed chief, who many of you may remember, Alan Greenspan. He was the Fed chief for 19 years and against four presidents. He was the most powerful man in the world financially. So I got 5 hours with him, 3 hours sucking into his brain psyche to figure out, you know, what's going on. And they had him on stage for 2 hours. And we talked about negative interest rates and volatility, all this crazy stuff. Things that have never happened in history are happening right now financially. That's why people are so fearful and uncertain. And so I said, my last question to him was, if you were made back the head of the Fed today, what's the first thing you'd do? And he paused, and everybody leaned in to hear, because, you know, it's most powerful men in the world. And he leaned in, and he said, resign. Mm-hmm. I was like, when the best guy in the world says resign, you know I have trouble. So I wanted to write a book that would protect people, because we all know a crash is coming. And if you're not in the market, you're still going to experience it if you're not prepared for it, because it affects the economy as a whole. And every 5 years we have, on average, we have a bear market or a crash. And it lasts a year, and it drops 33%. But every single one of those, you don't lose any money unless you sell. And it's really important for Americans to understand this, because America's unique. In 2.5 centuries, every crash is followed immediately by an explosion up in a bull market. So you all remember 2008. You remember the market, you know, dropped almost 50% from peak to trough, if you're aware of it. But from March 9th, what, a day or two from now is the celebration of it, it went up in the next 12 months, 69%, and it's been going up ever since for 250%. So you get really wealthy when those numbers change. So what I want to do is free people from the fear, not by enthusiasm or positive thinking, but by facts. The facts are there's a correction every year. You shouldn't be surprised when the market corrects. Last January was the worst opening in the history of the stock market, and we had a record-breaking year. People lost $2.2 trillion if they sold. But if they stayed, they went nowhere. So when you know that every single year there's going to be a correction, now a correction, by the way, means it drops 10 up to 20% from the peak. A bear market or crash is 20% or more. But every year since 1900, for 116 years, we've had a correction. It's like winter. You're not surprised when winter comes. Summer long, summer short, but you know what's coming.
You've even got a chapter in the book called Winter is Coming.
Yes, yes. It's my HBO special. But the reason I say that is, if you know it's coming, we want to prepare so you're protected. But also, for everyone listening, everyone who's joining us online, think about this. If you're a millennial, for example, and you got all this debt from college, it's so imbalanced right now, and you think you're never going to get free, or you're a baby boomer and you never got started and you think it's too late, believe it or not, the crash, the next crash, is the greatest opportunity in your life to leapfrog from where you are, where you don't want to be financially, to where you want to be, because everything goes on sale. Listen, the ladies in this room, if your favorite outfits or shoes are on sale for 50% off, you're pretty damn excited, right? Well, guys, if I said to you, what's your favorite car, and you said a Ferrari, and I say you get it for 50% off, guys would be out of their mind. But when the stock market drops 50%, it's on sale, most people freak out. Not Warren Buffett, not people like that. I interviewed a guy named Howard Marks. He was investing $1 billion a week in 2008 and 2009, when the market was through the floor. Now he's worth $100 billion because he bought everything for pennies. You got to think of it this way. When things are going really great, what do people want for the price of their home or the price of their stock or their business? It's real value or more? When it's going up like crazy, everybody wants more than it's worth. When it starts crashing, what will people take for their car, for their business, for their stocks? What will they take? Anything they can get. And so those opportunities are the greatest ones in your life. And here's what you gotta know. If you're stressed by worrying about the market or the economy, there's a correction every year. You're gonna be stressed forever. If you're 35 and you're gonna live to 85, you got 50 more corrections to go through. And you know, a bear market comes every 5 years, so you're gonna have 10 more bear markets in your life. Time to stop being stressed. Time to become unshakable, which simply means you have a plan. You know what's going on. You're not fearful because you know how this works long term, and you're not going to be taken advantage of. You're going to take advantage of the environment.
So one of my questions is about the stock market in general, because
yes,
this pretty much starts with you got to put your money in the market. But you also refer to the market as the game. And I've noticed there are a lot of financial players who say, you know, you've got to be in the game to win it. And when I hear game, I think of casinos, I think of the lottery. And I say, if I'm going to be smart about my money, I'm not going to play games with it. I'm going to just be safe with it. Can you talk about what it means to discuss the market as a game and how that might be a dangerous concept?
Sure. Well, first of all, the reason I called the other book Money Master the Game is that every wealthy person I interviewed called it a game.
Mm-hmm.
Every single one. And other people were saying, that's irresponsible. That's horrible to call it a game. This is the dumbest thing. But see, that mindset is what's keeping you from investing in the first place. So you can be in a game. It can be a difficult game. A challenging games are usually the ones that we like the most. But this is a game that can reward your family disproportionately to any other game that's out there. Now, some people play games aggressively. Some play things more in a secure way.
Mm-hmm.
Your style is more secure. And what I teach in this book is we want to have a style that makes you feel good. Because you may make a bunch of money, but you're stressed all the time. It's not worth it. There's a way to make money your slave instead of you being the slave to money. But let me explain. It's not put all your money in the market. It's really two things. It's first, you've got to decide the most important financial decision of your life, and that is to become an owner and not just a consumer.
Mm-hmm.
If you have I see a bunch of iPhones recording this right
and
now.
Just watch your foot, because there's a glass of water there.
Thank you for catching that. If you're I'm an active human, so you move around with me. But if you've got an iPhone and you don't own Apple, or better yet, you don't own the index of the S&P 500, the best 500 companies, you're making a giant mistake, because you'll never earn your way to financial fortune. Even people that make just loads of money, the actors, the actresses, the athletes, where are they 10 and 15 years later? I mean, 50 Cent made $100 million on vitamin water. He got a tip, and he got like a $200 or $300 million net worth, and he's bankrupt. He bought Mike Tyson's house, 25,000 square feet, and Mike Tyson made $500 million and went bankrupt. Right now, I don't know if you saw Johnny Depp, I don't know if it's gonna happen or not, but the papers are saying he may go bankrupt. He made $750 million as a movie star, but he spent $30,000 a month on wine, he must be feeling good. And secondly, he took Hunter Thompson, the reporter, he burned his body and paid $3 million to blow his ashes into the sky in a cannon. So no matter how much money you make, you can screw it up, right? But if you will just decide there's a percentage of my income that no matter what, I'm going to have it automated. I'm not going to see it. It's going to go straight to an investment account. And I don't know if it's 10 or 15 or 20. Those numbers sound gigantic to most people. Even if you start with 5 and build, that income does not go to anybody else. And then you put that into compounding. So listen to this. There's a young man, true story, a Theodore Johnson, 1950s, worked for UPS, never made more than $14,000 in annual income in his entire life, retired with $70 million, and he didn't inherit a dime. He gave away $35 million while he's alive. Now, how is that possible? Because of compound interest. When I interview all these investors and say, what's the biggest mistake Americans make? He said, they all said, they don't tap into compound interest. They know intellectually a little bit what it means, but they don't do it.
Mm-hmm.
They don't do it consistently. So what do you do?
It basically just means that the profits you make go back into the investment.
You keep reinvesting and it keeps growing, but it grows geometrically, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so a friend of his came to this man who worked for UPS and said, I'm going to make you rich. We're going to put a 20% tax on you. He said, I can't give up 20%. I can't pay my bills if I do that.
Mm-hmm.
He said, listen, if the government raised your taxes 20% and you'd claim, you'd scream, you'd cry, you'd complain, and you'd pay it. And you get adjusted to it. But he said, this is not going to the government. This is going into an account for your future. And that compounding is what made him that much money. In the book, I give you an example of an 18-year-old boy whose father convinces him that he should save $300 a month out of his income, which is not a huge income. It sounds like a lot. But when you automate it, you forget about it. It's perfect. You adjust. Well, he does this from 18 years old to 27 for 8 years. So the total amount of money, $300 a month, about $4,000 a year, that's $28,000 total. He then leaves it in the market and never adds a dime to it from 28 years old on. At 65, because the market over those 30 years grew 10%, his money has compounded so much that he has $1.8 million. You don't need a lot of money to be wealthy. You need time.
So you're saying that even if I have student debt that I'm struggling to pay off, even if I'm making, say, $1,000 a week, that I should still try to put a percentage or make it a point to put a percentage not just into a savings account, but into an investment account.
Into an investment account. Where to put that money, then we teach you the ways to do that, and it's got to be diversified.
Yeah.
You never put all your money in the market.
Okay, great. I want to ask you about brokers, because you say avoid brokers. Talk about the difference between a broker and a... I don't know how to pronounce it.
An F word.
Is it fiduciary?
Fiduciary.
Fiduciary. I tried saying it.
Give her a hand for that, ladies and gentlemen.
Talk about the differences and the dangers.
This is really critical. So let's assume that you've put something aside. By the way, I want to mention, if you feel like you can put nothing aside, I interviewed a man who was nominated for Nobel Prize in economics, and he came up with this cool idea. He said, you know, we all can go on a diet tomorrow. Right, we believe we're happy to do it. We can all save money tomorrow. So he created this program called Save Money for Tomorrow. And what he does is, he says, start with 3 or 5%. Anybody can do that. You'll never miss it. But then go to your employer, or if it's your business, set a target that says every time you get a salary increase, the first 5% goes straight into your investment account. And what happened, he did it in the Midwest with blue-collar workers who didn't have a large income, who'd never been able to save anything. And within 12 years, the average person was saving 17%. Remember my friend who saved 20% made $70 million. If you get numbers of 14, 15% consistently over the years, investing, especially the way we're showing you, where you protect yourself, you will have financial security and stability for a lifetime. You'll get to financial freedom. There's no question about it. But let's talk about who you go to now. Mm-hmm. So if you go to, there's 310,000 financial professionals in the United States. The Wall Street Journal says there's 200 names for them, all designed to impress you, right? So I am what? I'm a wealth manager. No, I'm a private wealth manager. No, I'm an ultimate private. They've got every name you can imagine. But 90% are brokers. Now, there's nothing wrong with a broker. They're good people. They work hard. They care. But they work for the house. Mm-hmm. The house always wins. They teach them to sell you products that are nice products, but they're not great, and they're full of fees. So you're never going to maximize in the place that they do this. And the reason is they're not bad companies. They're designed to make profit for their shareholders. They're not designed to make you the most profit. So you come second, third, fourth. And how do they make more profit? More fees. How to get more fees? Have you not know it by making it as confusing as possible.
So it's about conflicts of interest, right?
It's total conflict. So watch. 10% of those 310,000, 31,000 people in the whole country are considered fiduciaries. That's the F word.
Fiduciary.
Fiduciary.
Stay with me.
You got it, ladies and gentlemen.
I got it.
So let me clarify. What it means is these people are under the law required to put your needs ahead of their own. Now, if you go to Australia, the UK, most countries in the world, not only are doctors and lawyers fiduciaries, just like our country, that lawyer has to put you first. That doctor has to put your needs ahead of their own. Mm-hmm. They can't order tests just to add up fees for themselves. And if they do, there's severe consequences.
Okay.
We're the only country like that in America because of the financial lobby. They're not fiduciaries. You have to decide to be a fiduciary. And if you do, they're called RIAs, registered investment advisors, or fiduciaries. And so if they tell you to buy Apple this morning, and they buy Apple tonight and they get a better price, they have to give you their stock. That's how strong the law is. That is not true for any broker. But then I found something else out. And that is, out of the 31,000 people that have to put you first, 26,000 of them are duly registered, which means they're a broker and a fiduciary. So if you say, are you a fiduciary? They'll say, yeah, I'm just here. I'm going to just guide you. I'm not going to sell you anything I benefit from. But in the middle of the conversation, they put on a new hat and they sell you a product that they get a big commission on after they said that they're here just to give you advice. It's like if you went to a butcher and said, what should I eat? You know he's going to sell you meat. That's what he sells. If you go to a dietitian, and the butcher's a good guy. He probably eats the same meat. He's probably fat and in trouble too, right? But if you go to a dietitian, you're not paying him to sell you anything. You're paying them to be independent, registered investment advisor as an independent advisor. And so what they're going to do is they're going to go, wait a second, too much of that meat, you're going to get cancer. We need some salad. We need some veggies. We need a little fish here. And they're not being incentivized to sell you anything, right? They just get a fee for what they do. That's the person you want. There's only 5,000 in the entire United States out of 310,000, 1.6%. That's why most people get screwed. And here's what you got to know. You hear numbers like 1%, 2%, 3%. Sounds like nothing.
But compounding.
You got it. So watch this.
I read it. I learned something.
Most of you, how many of you have a 401k in this room? I'm curious. Most of you. So a 401k is where most people put their money. It's a great idea. But where do you put your money in that 401k? You're given choices. They're mutual funds, actively managed mutual funds. The average mutual fund, first of all, they get on that platform by paying to get on. It's called pay to play. It's the way they used to do the radio business, and they made it illegal. So you're not getting the best. You're getting whoever paid them at the 401k place the most. And then they get all that money back out of you by having 17 hidden fees. So you think you might be paying 1%, and you're paying 3.12. So you go, okay, Tony, what's the difference between 1 and 3? Because of compounding, here's what it is. Let's say you got $100,000 and you're 35. A lot of people within the range of 35 in this room will use that number. You put 100 grand in, you've built it up over your life, you saved it, you invested it, you put it in the market. And let's say you never put another dime in. 30 years later, that market grows at 8%, let's say, conservatively. Well, if you had 3% in fees, your $100,000 is growing to $432,000. Pretty exciting. 400 from 100, you added nothing. But if you paid 1% in fees, you own the same stocks, but only 1% in fees, you have $762,000. You have almost twice as much money. The first person's gonna run out of money, by the way, trying to spend that income. By the time they're 74, 75, the person who has more money is gonna last the 93.
So I am totally afraid of conflicts of interest, sort of beyond all else, because it just feels like someone who's smarter than me is going to get in my brain. And I just want to give you the opportunity to clarify something, which is the disclaimer at the beginning of your book, which is that you're promoting companies that you have a financial stake in.
Yeah.
So can you just reconcile the difference between a broker's conflict of interest and you promoting your own companies within
your
book?
Mine is right up front. We tell you exactly what it is. And so I'm a partner in creative planning. Mm-hmm. So we haven't gotten who my co-author is. My co-author is Peter Malouk. Peter is the number one rated wealth manager in America by Barron's 3 years in a row. No one's done that in the history of the United States. Mm-hmm. 2 years in a row by CNBC, and this year Forbes made their own list and he's number one. So I'm on his board, I'm a partner, I'm in the business. But when you come decide, let's say you want to figure out how you're going to build a plan, you can go to getasecondopinion.com, and if you do business with us, I'll benefit. But you can submit to them and say, here's what I'm doing. They'll evaluate it, they'll put a plan together, or if you're doing nothing, they'll put a plan together for you. And if you want to become a client, it's 1% or less. And we have a clear piece, and that's all you pay. There's no commissions. There's no product that we own that we sell. All of it is clear and transparent.
So it's the transparency that keeps the conflict of interest from
being a
problem. So
you know. You have no idea when you're paying 3% and you're being cheated out of 2/3 of your income. Every 1% you overpay above 1% for your investments, because the fees compound, will cost you 10 years of income. So if you're paying 3% instead of 1, you gave up 20 years of retirement income, and you could have owned the same product, the same stocks, the same bonds for less than 1%.
I really, really appreciate you clarifying that.
Of course, I do it in every interview. We just hadn't gotten to Peter or talked about it yet.
Yeah, of course. I want to ask you about a different kind of investment,
and
that's specifically investing in art.
Right.
I think you do a lot of work in investment, a lot of work in philanthropy, and I think of investing, say, in a Broadway show, which is my personal passion, is Broadway.
Please don't do that.
Well, here's the thing.
That's
right?
Not saying I want to invest in a movie. That's the wrong place to start.
If
here's how you go from a billionaire to a millionaire. You invest in movies and Broadway shows.
How do I budget to sort of invest in a philanthropic way? Like, if there's an artist that I believe in who I want to support financially, do I budget it as if it's philanthropy and cross my fingers that it will turn into an investment?
No. All of my philanthropy is my philanthropy. I don't try to convince myself that while I'm doing philanthropy, I'm making good investment. It's the wrong way to evaluate things, because you'll find yourself being emotionally connected to an investment, and it's not. This can't be an emotional game. This has got to be a game where you have clear rules. This is how I do it. I don't risk anything. I take the money I've earned by being disciplined, and now I can give it away and do the things I want to do. So I feed, to give you an idea, 250,000 people a day. I provide fresh water to in India, because kids are killed every day. They die every day of waterborne diseases. The easiest thing to solve. So my goal is to 1 million. I'm going to get to 1 million kids. I just got back. I can't say where, because it was a rather public thing. But I was just in a third world country, and I've donated about $1.5 million to an organization called Underground Railroad, which I went there. I went to this third world country with all these former CIA, FBI, and special forces guys. And what they do is, we have more slavery today than any time in human history, because the population's so big and we're just not managing it well. So we freed 36 children. girls 9 years old to 13, chained to a bed having sex with people, freed them all, and caught 13 of the biggest perpetrators in that country and ended their careers and put them in jail. So I can do those things, and those are things that match my values, what I'm about, what I'm committed to. The internet is worthless if you can't read and write, if you're illiterate. 1 out of 7 humans are illiterate in this world. 250 million children are literate, and there's no way with our demographics we'll have enough teachers to make that happen. So I donated $1 million. Elon Musk donated, I think, $4 million. Together we created, with a group of other people, a $15 million prize. And we have all these teams competing with iPads that we're giving these children in Africa, and with no teacher, in 18 months, they teach themselves to read, write, and do arithmetic. They win the $15 million. But the code is open source, so that we're gonna distribute it to the whole world. Mm-hmm. All of these things I do because I've become successful as a businessman and as an investor. I don't try to do those as part of my investing because it's just not the right way to do it. If I'm lucky enough to find something that I believe in, I wanna invest in, and it also does great social good, I love that. But I don't try to always do that because there aren't that many opportunities. Very often things that are social good aren't run well as a business. Mm-hmm. But I still wanna support it. So let me do that as philanthropy. Let me do that as a donation. Let me not try to make money off of it. Does that make sense?
It does. I still want there to be a way for me to give money to the art that I love.
You can. You can invest in art you love, but I would suggest you first get your financial house in order where you're going to be financially set.
So if that money just goes away, then I can...
In the hole, have it given to somebody else. If you get on an airline, what's the first thing they tell you? If there's a problem, the mask will drop down, and the first thing you got to do is put it on your child, right? Isn't that what most of us want to do?
Yes.
It sounds so selfish, put on yourself first. But if you don't take care of yourself first, you're not going to help any more artists.
Yeah.
So you got to watch the direction you go.
I love
your heart, but we got to set you up with a better system.
You got to get my wallet in order first. Yes. We have time for some questions from
the
audience if you're up for it.
I'm all for that.
We're going to start over here.
Hi, how are you? My name is Grisella.
Nice
to meet you. By the way, I am an insurance broker.
Awesome.
So now I have to look into being a fiduciary.
Well, insurance brokers are a little different, but yes, being a fiduciary would be helpful.
Yes. So like my a person such as myself, I have a company 401k and they match everything that I invest 100%. However, I am looking into investing in other stocks and other markets on my own. However, I do not have that knowledge. So what would be your advice of how I can gain knowledge of how to invest? Because it would be like investing 101 for me.
I understand. I wrote this book so someone who's advanced could do it or somebody just beginning the journey. And I wrote Money Master the Game the same way. It's just a bigger book.
Yes.
But what I would do is you got to educate yourself. If you go to unshakeable.com, I have a free set of podcasts there also. So you could go even deeper. You can listen while you're driving your car. You can use what I call net time, you know, no extra time to support what you're learning. But you just need to educate yourself. And I'm telling you, I interviewed the best in the world. And if you look at the back of the book, people that have never endorsed a financial book do it. But pick those books up, read those, you'll know what to do. And then get yourself a plan and start to implement. I mean, it really, truly is that simple. And if you're delaying, like some of you might say, yeah, but Tony, the market's really frothy right now. I hear we keep breaking records. On average, we break a record once a month. Now, sometimes it goes 7 days in a row, but that's the average. And here's the other thing. There was great research done by J.P. Morgan, and they found something interesting. If you're trying to time the market, forget it. Warren Buffett told me, he said, the only reason you have these forecasters, market forecasters on CNBC is to make fortune tellers look good, because nobody does it successfully. But what he also taught me was, if you're going to be successful, you got to understand that if you're out of the market, that's the most dangerous thing you could be, even if you have a small amount of money. I said, how could that be? Because if you miss the 10 best trading days of the last 20 years, instead of having an 8.2% return, which means you double your money every 9 years, mm-hmm. which is what most people did if they're in the index, the S&P 500, I'm talking in shorthand. But if you just miss the 10 top trading days in 20 years, your return's 4.5% cut in half. If you miss the top 20 days, you make 2%, you might as well have had a bond. If you miss the top 30 days, because you think you're trying to time the market, you think it's not a good time, then you lose money. In the same exact market. So you gotta be in the market. You say, but what if I get in tomorrow and then it crashes? Great. JP Morgan did a study on that also, so did Charles Schwab independently. Guess what they found out? They took one group and said, this person is gonna get in on the best day. It's Miss Genius. Somehow the market crashed. She got in the worst day and it went straight up. So she's gonna do well. Second person, they got on the worst day, Mr. Idiot. The day the market hit its peak, they got in, the next day it crashed. Third person is called dollar cost averaging. They invest the same amount every month, no matter what the prices are, and that averages it out. And the first person says, I'm staying out of this thing. It's too scary. I'm going to be in cash. And then they look at where are they 20 years later. Well, you know who's worse off. The cash person has no money, right? Who's best off? The person with the best timing. But here's what's amazing. The person who got in on the worst day, if they stayed in the market and they're there for 20 years, they only have $14,000 less after 20 years than the person on the best day. So the most dangerous thing to do is not to be an owner, to not be in the market. If you stay in the market and you don't sell, the market takes nothing from you. And if you look at history, in American history, 2.5 centuries, it could change, but for 2.5 centuries, through World War I, World War II, recessions, depressions, overseas challenges, Brexit, we've all been able to continue to grow. You don't want to bet against the United States. You want to be in it.
We didn't even get a chance to talk about the psychology and the neurology that goes into investing, but which is really my favorite part of this book, so I highly encourage everybody to get it just for that part alone. But this seems related because one of the things that you discuss is the dopamine rush you get by checking your stocks every day.
It's and the worst thing you can do.
Well, that's exactly right, and it seemed related to what you were just saying in terms of you talk about putting money in once a month and then seeing where you are in 20 years. And you quote an expert in the book who says, only look once a year max.
Yeah, the ideal really is that. But if you only have to rebalance, and we explain what that means, how to do it, so that you stay on the ideal path once a year. So if the market crashed, you might reevaluate, but literally once a year for the most part is where that is. If you look at every day, it's like looking at grass waiting for it to grow. And it goes up, it goes down, it goes around. You know, most living things cycle up and down and around, right? If you see a straight line in nature, that wasn't nature. Mm-hmm. A human did that. We wind up a little down, but the overall growth is up. That's the market. And if ever it starts coming down, you go, oh my God, it's going down. It's going to go down at least once a year, and it's going to drop at least 14%, and it's going to last at least 2 months, so you shouldn't be surprised. It's winter, and you go, you know what? Instead of freezing to death or being afraid, I'm going to ski, snowboard, be with my friends and family. If you don't react and you stay in the game, you're going to win. Jack Bogle, who I interviewed, who's created Vanguard. Most of you may have heard of Vanguard. It's a $3 trillion company. He's been in the stock market business for 65 years. He's in his 80s. He's one of the most respected men in the business. He said the secret to wealth is get in the market and stay there and do nothing. And he's absolutely right. He's absolutely right, because it's a long-term thing. If you're trading in and out, you're going to, first of all, have lots of commissions to pay. You're going to have costs going up and down. And I'll tell you something else. Ladies in this room, you're all better investors than men on average. Most men are overconfident. It's one of the psychological things. And so they overtrade. They think, I can do better. I can beat the market. So the average man earns 2.5% less than the average woman, because she just goes in and goes, I'm going to leave it there. I'm not going to mess with this stuff. I don't think I'm smarter than the market. And so women actually do better as investors overall than men do in the general population.
You have a great quote that says, acknowledging that you have no special advantage is the biggest advantage you can have an investor. And I'm definitely taking that away with me.
And Warren Buffett also said, he told me, he said, Tony, he said, listen to me. He said, the stock market is a game of transferring money from the impatient people to the patient people that just stayed.
I love that.
And I thought, come over Warren Buffett, that's pretty good.
I want to make sure we get to at least one more question.
Yes, please.
Hi, Tony. You always say that the secret to living is giving, and there's this very famous story you have of having no money at all and giving away your last dollar to someone in need.
Yes.
So I was just wondering how you balance giving with self-care, especially as it relates to finances.
Ladies take care of, and it's a gross generalization, but I think it's true because of the biochemistry of raising a child. Ladies tend to nurture everybody else more than themselves first. Men, very often, they're not just selfish jerks. Sometimes they are.
They can be.
But they're raised to be more competitive. They're not, you know, they're not in that same mode, and so they don't do as well. But I think, really and truly, the balance to me is you need clear goals, because you see the same thing that's happening here. Two women, and she's like, I want to give it all away to those people. And I used to do the same thing, but then I had nothing left over because the things I invested in, I was so emotionally connected to that I stayed with them even when they were bad investments because I liked the people. And that's not how you invest. You invest, make your money, and then give it away. Your family, your friends, yourself, the people that are involved with that. But you need to separate them. How do you find the balance? It's really art more than science. But for me, the way I did it is, you alluded to the fact that I had a stage in my life where I was just so frustrated. I was down the last $19 I had. I didn't drive my car because I didn't want to pay the gas. I walked 3 miles, not very far, to this restaurant on the water so I could try and change my psyche. And I saw this little boy come in with his mom, but he was in a suit, and he pulled the chair up for it, and he was so loving. And I'm sitting there chowing down because I want to pay $5.95 for all you can eat at this taco bar so I can load up for the winter, you know, like the last 3 days because I'm down to my last $19, right? You know? And so I saw this boy. I couldn't help it. I was so moved by him. And so when I was done chowing down, paid my money, and I don't know, I'd left, you know, I think I had like $23. So by the time I was done, it was $17, $18, $19, whatever it was. And I walked to this little boy and I introduced myself. I said, "Hi, my name's Tony," and I forgot his first name. I think he said, "I'm Charlie," I think it was. And I said, "Charlie," I said, "I'm so impressed by you. I said, I saw you have the door open for your woman here. I saw you pull the chair out for her. I saw you sit down here, and you're looking right in her eyes, and you're just so with her, and you're so sincere, and you're taking her to lunch like this." I said, "You are a class act." He looks up, and he goes, "I'm not taking her lunch because I'm just 8, and I'm, you know, I don't have a job yet." And maybe he was 8 or 9. And I think he was in the 3rd or 4th grade is what it was. He told me his grade is what it was first. And he goes, "I'm 8 or 9. And I said, "Yes, you are taking her lunch." And I had no plan. I just reached in my pocket spontaneously, took all the money I had on earth, which wasn't much, $79, and I slammed it down in front of him. And I said, "You are taking her to lunch." He goes, "But she's my mom." I said, "Even better." And he goes, "I can't accept this." And I said, "Yes, you can." He said, "I'll come." I said, "Because I'm bigger than you are."
I bet you're a lot bigger than you are.
And then I didn't look at her. I wasn't doing it for attention. I walked out that door. My car wasn't there because I'd walked. I flew home. And I got home. I had no money. No idea I was going to eat my next meal. How am I going to pay my rent? But I felt the most free I've ever felt in my entire life. It was like I finally got beyond scarcity. And I woke up the next morning, still no plan, but like lifted, like my spirit lifted, just feeling so, because I did what was right. I didn't plan. I just did it spontaneously. And the next day, there was a guy I'd been chasing for 3 months. I was so out of money. I loaned him $1,000 like a year before. He kept avoiding my calls. And I get a snail mail. I'm that old. I got an old snail mail came in the next day. And I opened this thing up. And it's a check for $1,000+ interest, almost $1,200. So then that would have lasted me a month. And the most powerful thing was what came out of it for me is I thought, why did this happen? And then I just started to cry and cry. And I realized in that moment, this happened because I did what was right. I didn't do things for brownie points. I didn't do it for positioning. I just, my heart knew was right. And I did it. And I was rewarded. You know, it's like the money showed up.
But how is that different from me wanting to give my last paycheck to the Broadway show I want to invest in?
It's not different than that. If you did that once, it would be good. If you do it regularly, you're in trouble.
Fair enough.
And I also know more than now. So I'm able to help so many more people because I've become prosperous. Right? Think of all the human beings. This last year, I provided 100 medical scholarships for people. I gave you a list of all the things I do. I'm not doing it to impress you. I'm telling you it impresses me that my life has changed that much, but because I developed these disciplines, I can do all that. Mm-hmm. So I'm not telling you to wait. You can still go give something. I think you should. If you won't give a dime out of a dollar, you're not gonna give 10 million out of 100 million ever. It starts with where you are. And a lot of people say, "Well, he's rich or you're rich, you go do that. When I'm rich, I'll do it." You won't if you don't do it today. But you don't wanna disproportionately do it to where it hurts you and you don't move forward. So I love your heart. I share your heart, yours as well. But the art of it, find things you can do where you can give, and maybe every now and then give the shirt off your back, but better yet, do a plan so you don't have to give the shirt off your back and you can provide shirts for lots of backs or whatever would be the right metaphor for you.
Oh, that's great.
That's your question?
We have another question over here.
Yes, of course.
Hi, my name is Robin. I'm a local New York City person. I'm actually a math educator, so I call myself Robin the Math Lady. So
wow.
I was curious to know if you've teamed with schools or how this would play out with younger people, high school students, middle school students, and especially thinking of exponential functions. And
We have a kids camp we do every year. We bring kids in from all over the world for, and we bring in leaders, both negative leaders and positive, meaning kids that are gang-oriented, and we bring them together and merge them. And while we're there, we teach them some of the economics. But my foundation provides all these resources. I'll provide books for the whole school for if you want, and we can provide a bit of an education. You can decide what stage, what age group are you dealing with?
Right now I teach at the college level, but I go into a lot of schools as a student teacher supervisor all over New York City. So.
If you wanted to take our material and do that, and it's for nonprofit purposes, I'll support you 100%.
Okay.
So
okay.
You can
thank
see
you.
Me afterwards. I'll give you one of our cards
okay.
and we'll follow
thank
up.
Thank you. Okay.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
That's wonderful. I think we have time for one more.
Hi. Hi, Tony. It's fantastic to meet you.
Thank you.
My brain's teeming now, and I'm not a numbers person, but I just want to say, I don't know what I want to say. I have a small business here because I wanted to live in the US, and there's no heart anywhere. I'm in a power struggle with people. I don't know who to trust. I'm not creating anything. I'm not giving anything to anybody. I'm just in survival.
Why?
because it wasn't going very well, and I took two new partners in and a lawyer, and I thought he was acting on my behalf, he was acting on their behalf, he's taken a small percentage, and they're all head of this and head of that, I'm the owner.
Yes.
And they're like, no, we're above you. And I had my first experience in yoga being treated like a woman, like pushed to the side, not listened to,
well,
not heard.
Well, that's not being treated like a woman, that's just being treated badly.
Well, I think it was because I'm a woman, they thought they could walk all over me. So
well, actually, it might be, but it might be that they walk over anybody. People who are strong business people walk over anyone who they have more experience than. And so, look, 96% of all businesses over 10 years go bankrupt. Only 4% survive. That doesn't even mean they're profitable. So business is not an easy thing, and the reason is because 80% of success in business is psychology, 20% is strategy and mechanics. So your psychology right now has been messed with. You're living in a state, for lots of good reasons, of frustration and a bit of overwhelm and a lot of stress. And in that state, you're not going to create solutions. And right now, you're focused on how they were the problem. And there's truth to that. But the real problem is you. The real problem was you weren't educated before you began, which is how most people start a business. And so, you know, the old phrase they say, when a person with experience meets people with money, they end up with your money and you end up with experience, right? And that's kind of what's happened to you. Yeah. So here's what you need to do. I don't know what this business, you either turn this one around or you need to get away and start something fresh, but you need to educate yourself. I will do you a very big favor if you're interested. I do a boot camp for business people that lasts 5 days and nights. I do it twice a year in the United States. It's $10,000 to go. It's all business owners. Some have just started. Some are billion-dollar companies. Some are, you know, doing less than a million. And if you go and put through that experience, I'll give it to you as a gift if you promise me that what you will do is then go out and teach three people what I teach you. If you're up for that, I'll do it.
Wow.
You up for it? Shake this hand. You see my assistant over here, Sarah, not this Sarah, but my Sarah, in the back there, and she'll arrange it for you, all right? And my only request is I want to see the impact, all right?
Absolutely.
You're welcome.
Thank you so
what
much.
A
God
bless. Generous gesture. Unfortunately, we're out of time. As I predicted backstage, we could have had this conversation for another 8 hours. I know you have the energy to do it. I just want to thank you so much for being here and for sharing all of the fruits of your life's work with us.
Well, thank you. You did a beautiful job jamming it all in. Thank you so much. I really appreciate it. Thank you, guys.